Hello everyone, and welcome at the Thursday Morning Science webinar. Today it is the 11th of February and we want to celebrate the International Day for Women and Girls in Science. This day has been promoted by the United Nations and we want to join this initiative as an opportunity to promote full and equal access to and participation in science for women and girls. So the University of L'Aquila has been, and it is very active, in the study and monitoring of gender issues in academia. Among the other things, these days we have posted on the social media of the university some interviews to women who reached very, very relevant and international positions thanks to their scientific preparation. So I invite all of you to check them out on the Facebook and Instagram and on the webpage of the university. And also at the TMS, we wanted to contribute to this day, and that's why we wanted to invite Professor Laura Tarantino, who is here today. Laura Tarantino is an Associate Professor of Computer Architectures and of Interactive Systems Design at the University of L'Aquila. Among the other things, she is an electronic engineer, but she has also many other interests related to art, which I hope she will talk about. And she is a member, for instance, of the management board and of the scientific board of ICONA, which is an inter-university and a multidisciplinary research center focused on cognitive elaboration in natural and artificial systems. She is also co-founder and co-coordinator of Theta Lab, a multidisciplinary interdepartment research laboratory focused on the technology-enhanced treatment of autism. And she's also co-coordinator of PIN Camp, that is a summer school happening at the University of L'Aquila, which is dedicated to high school girls and to guide them towards STEM disciplines. I hope that, or I'm sure that Professor Tarantino will tell us about her research activity, and we also hope to hear about duties or her interests in this activity related, for instance, to PIN Camp. So I am very happy that Professor Tarantino accepted our invitation, and then I let her start the webinar. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Denise. I start to share my screen to start my presentation. Okay. So, as Denise said, I'm a computer scientist, but I'm actually a contaminated computer scientist fluctuating among different, somehow opposite extremes related to science from one side and art. Art and music and dance from the other side. I have an education in human studies, actually, and ballet and music in general. And so the title of my that I choose for my seminar may be somehow misleading. Women in computer science are not necessarily too nerd. It may you think that I consider nerdiness as a bad thing, which is actually is not the case, and I would fight if someone would steal my nerd side. I'm not against being nerd, but I'm against stereotypes that assume that you must be nerd if you are a woman working in science or in technology. I'd like to start with a commercial that you may have seen.
Ti piacerebbe avere un sito web?
Maybe.
Questa è la piastra Dyson Corral.
Okay, I would have liked to start with this commercial.
La spinta è creata dalla propulsione, è questione di fisica. L'aerodinamica di un aereo.
So, what we see here is this stereotype image for, because if you are even a baby girl talking about science or aerodynamics or technology, you have to be a little nerd. For example, you have to wear glasses. You cannot talk, if you are a woman, you cannot talk about science if you don't wear glasses. But my point is that if you are a woman, you can talk about science even wearing ballet point shoes. That's the point. And actually, here we have Fabiola Giannotti, who is the Director General at CERN since 2016. And she is the first person who have been selected for a second term. So she is starting now, it has just started in January, her second mandate as a Director General at CERN. She's a physics, but she is also, sorry, a trained ballerina and graduated in piano at the conservatory. And we see that this is a first example in which we can see how women working in science are not stereotyped and focused only on one issue. So I have a lot of stuff to touch in this seminar. I hope to be able to say everything. I will start from some consideration about STEM disciplines, that is science, technology, engineering and mathematics, labor market and women. Then I will touch some obstacles and enemies that keep girls far from STEM disciplines. I would briefly introduce a different perspective on the relationship between technology and human beings. I will survey a particular field in computer science, which is the field of human-computer interaction, to show an example, same idea of technology-centered view of women working in computer science. As an example application domain, I will survey the result of a study we made at ETA Lab about the usage of virtual reality application to treat people with autism spectrum disorders. And finally, as a promo, I will briefly present PIN Camp, which is a summer school, a DSIM initiative. DSIM is my department for bringing girls to computers, to STEM, actually, not only computer science. So, starting from the labor market, there are some official reports from European Union Commission, which show that in spite of a constantly increasing job offer in these fields, we can see a persistent skill shortage, which is particularly pronounced in technological occupation. There are several factors behind this situation. There's a general and gender independent decline of pupil interest in STEM subjects, but in particular, there's a persisting underrepresentation of women among STEM graduates. There are several factors behind this underrepresentation of women, which is worldwide. This is not, an Italian scenario. This is worldwide. Surely we have that families play a key role pushing children to conform to traditional gender roles, and often also teachers and peers reinforce this stereotype. As a result, if we look at this picture here, we can see that, for example, in science and between science and engineering professionals that refer to knowledge-intensive a profession like engineer, architecture, science in general. And in this other part of the picture, we have so-called science and engineering associate professional, which are more technical occupation. In both cases, the field is dominated by males. For example, and this situation is even worse in computer science. There's an interesting study which analyzed the gender balance in computer science through the lens of research paper authorship. And in particular, they examine how gender balance is changing over time through a corpus of almost 3 million papers published between 1970 and 2018. And they found out that at the current rate of growth, which is represented in this picture, we will never reach parity actually, but we will reach at least 45% of female authorship around 2137. That means in 116 years from now. Meanwhile, what is happening? If we consider the role that research has in the technology innovation, we are experiences a society. We know how our society, particularly in this period, in this area, is dominated by information and communication technology, and the COVID emergency accentuated this relationship and our and the extent to which we rely on technology for carry on our relationship with people, for carry on our jobs and studies and everything. Actually, this ICT-based society in this moment and for the next 100 years will be designed and shaped by men, actually by white men to be more precise, which is not good. Actually, women and girls are missing interesting opportunities. Some other official reports of European Union Commission studied two scenarios aimed at closing the gender gap in STEM, a slower growth and a faster growth. And in both cases, we can see an impressive improvement in the gross domestic product, which by 2050 can be increased by between 600 and 800 billion euro if you close the gender gap, and also an increase in employment by 850,000 to 1,200,000 job positions, which are likely to be with high wages. So there is a lot of interesting opportunities that girls are missing. What is hampering the participation of women in STEM. There are many factors. I will just survey a couple. I mean, I already touched the role of families and school, but there is also there are also some global cultural problems. For example, a study in the large, which monitored traditional media for 20 years, found out that, for example, in the news, women are confined in a sort of professional anonymity. Their profession are often not mentioned in news. In the 41% of cases, the profession is not considered relevant for the news. For example, if there is a car accident and a person is killed, if this person is a man, the news goes like a lawyer or a politician has been killed in this accident. If the person killed by the accident is a woman, you can typically find things like a mother of three was killed in the accident. And actually, in the 28% of cases, women are presented on the basis of family relationship, mother of, wife of, daughter of. In the case of men, this happens only in the 8% of cases. And you can be the most powerful woman in the world. You may have served as Secretary of State of the most powerful country in the world. You may have run for the presidency of the United States of America, but you don't escape this destiny, and you are presented as wife of somebody else, and you don't even deserve a surname. I mean, this is a big example that shows this situation. Furthermore, there are other stereotypes in the way in which, for example, movies and TV series depict women working in computer science and in information and communication technology. They are often represented as weird person or losers, and actually a representation like this cannot, stimulate girls in embracing careers like this. And this is the result of this. If we look at the distribution of female students enrolled in higher education on a world basis, we find that STEM are this portion here, which amounts to about 30% of the total. And within STEM, we find this big sector here, about half of the whole portion of STEM studies, which is 15%, which is related to health and welfare, for example, medicine. While 8% is in engineering, 5% natural sciences, mathematics, and statistics, and only 3% in information and communication technology. And computer science is only a portion of this 3%. We have another picture here, showing student expectation on science career by subfield of studies out of those who choose science careers when students are 15 years old. In the case of female, we have here 74% expecting to work as a health professional, while in most cases is only 24%. About authorship, we can compare the the reaching of that 45% of authorship in papers in computer science, and the same study conducted in the Medline bibliographic database that includes studies on life science and biomedical information like medicine, pharmacy, among others. And we can see that the same 45% balance is reached in 2050 in this case. That means 30 years from now, compared to the 116 years in computer science. Actually, are facing two different perspectives. So, if you are a woman, it is socially acceptable in some sense to work in science, to talk about science, if these science studies are human-centered. But it's somehow a taboo to work in science if the career is more technology or system-centered. So we have these two opposite views, human-centered and system-centered. Human-centered is okay, technology-centered is bad. And this perspective is stereotyped. Stereotyped because it's true that healthcare profession and biology, for example, and pharmacy can be human-centered. But this is the other myth I want to debunk today. Also, technology career can be human-centered. So even if there's nothing bad in being nerd, if you don't want to be nerd and if you don't want to be to follow a nerd career, you can fulfill your human-centered expectations even if you work in ICT or computer science. Actually, there is another myth to debunk, that is that technological artifacts are somehow far from human. Here we have a citation from Martin Cooper, which was the chief engineer in the team which developed the first prototype of mobile phone back in 1973. And in an interview of about 20 years ago, he said that he viewed mobile phones like communication prostheses, allowing anyone to have relation with the surrounding world mediated by transparent technology. In some sense, it was a visionary, because now we are actually living this way. Actually, this view of communication processes is mutated from anthropologists who look at technical artifacts as a means to overcome the adaptive deficiencies of a human being, sort of organic extension indissociable from humans. There's an interesting view of Marshall McLuhan, who looks at invention as technological artifacts in general, as stimulated by the stress coming from either accelerating the pace or increasing the load, up to auto-amputate some organs. There are the classical example of, the English name from for Lancia. I mean, we want to reach an animal far from us. We cannot touch the animal with our arm, and so we amputate our arm, we make our arm become a Lancia, and we throw away the Lancia. Another classical example is that of the fork, which has the same shape of our hand, okay? And so the Lancia, I don't know in English, the English name, and the fork are sort of prosthesis indissociable from us. And now we have a different problem of accelerating pace or increasing load. For example, now we are facing a huge volume of information to handle, to master and memorize, and we cannot afford this memorization load with our brain, so we put this off our brain in external memories, which are a sort of cognitive processes of our brain. Or we want to look at things which are far from us, so we amputate an eye and we throw an eye far from our location, and that's where webcam come from. So we see that talking about technological artifacts means talking about human beings. And we have to start from the human being for studying and conceiving and implementing technological artifacts. There is no actual separation from an anthropological point of view. Actually, we have to say that while more ancient disciplines like architecture are consolidated disciplines, and they already put the human being as the central focus of their work. Computer science and in general information communication technology are very young disciplines, and young disciplines tend to be a bit auto-referential, so we have also to make sort of critical to our critics to our work. And so maybe if we are too auto-referential, we are too much focused on the artifacts, forgetting where the artifacts come from, which is the human. But there's some field in computer science that put the human at the center of their study, and this is the case of human-computer interaction. Human-computer interaction is actually a multidisciplinary field, including computer science, engineering, design, cognitive science, psychology, all related in the process of conceiving and implementing application. Human computer interaction, the term human, I mean, it's a key point. For example, the CKI, which is the main international community of professional working in human computer interaction, in their official side put that the mission of CKI is to support the professional growth of its members who are interested in how people interact with technology and how technology changes society. So the role of the technology is not looked as separated by the way in which people live, and actually all projects founded on human-computer interaction starts from studying users, their needs and their tasks. If we look at any interactive tool, in a very simple way, an interactive tool can be seen as having something called user interface, which is a bit obsolete as term, but still effective, which is everything we see of the object. For example, in a smartphone, the user interface is all we can see. And then there's what we cannot see, which is the engine, which is inside, the part of the artifacts that processes user request. Well, in traditional approaches, the artifacts is designed starting from the engine. The engine is conceived and implemented first. The user interface is implemented afterwards to adapt to the engine. Since the users interact with the user interfaces, and a system-centered approach like this oblige the users to adapt to the engine, to adapt to the system, and this is the system-centered view of design. But human-computer interaction promoted a sort of cultural revolution, inverting the two design steps. The design starts from studying the users, their needs and their tasks, and I said before, and then conceive and design the user interface, implement a prototype of the user interface, or more generally, user interaction environment, and then the second step is to implement the engine as something responding to the user interface. So in this case, this is the human-centered the design and methodology. In this case, is the system that has to adapt to the users. This is a sketch of how the human-centered methodology works. Is an iterative process. I mean, it is not a sequential process, starting from the users and ending with the system, but is an iterative process, starting with ideas about the artifacts, prototyping, testing with users, refining ideas, re-prototyping, retesting with user, and so forth, until user satisfaction is reached. Okay, there are studies called the usability evaluation, and the usability evaluation measures three aspects: efficacy of the product, efficiency of the product, and satisfaction of final users, which are, I mean, the central part, actually, in the logo of Sikai, which is that the human being is the central aspect of the logo. Everything goes around users. This is, the user-centered design methodology steps more precisely.
Sorry, people should switch off their microphones. Thanks.
Okay, these are, the steps of the user-centered methodology. I will skip this. It doesn't add any important, but I would like to spend some words on this other design framework, which actually originated not in the human-computer interaction field, but in the information system field. And put an emphasis on three pillars in the design process: the environment, the design process itself, and the corpus of knowledge. And we see here this interesting relevance cycle. In the environment, from the environment, we select problems which turn into design opportunities. We select also requirements from people, from organizational system, and to technical system. And then design results are returned to the environment to be tested in the real environment. A similar view is shared by another design approach, a recent design approach, design thinking. In this case, the three pillars are business, technology, and people. And the innovation is regarded as a combination of these three people. So the desires of people are a crucial part. If we give a closer look to design thinking, an interesting characteristic of the pull out two macro phase in the design process. A first macro phase is which is the problem definition, which starts from an understanding of the application domain, observation of users, and then a converging phase of point of view, which ends to the definition of requirements. This first macro phase corresponds to single out the right thing to do, the relevant thing to do. I mean, similarly to the previous framework I showed. And then there is the more technical part, the problem solution. So the technical part of the design is devoted to provide a solution to the problem we single out previously. And this is to do the thing right. But both macro phases have the same importance. They are depicted with the same dimension because they have the same importance. Here, even if we see here this path, we do not have to think that the process is strictly sequential, because this circle allow us to going back. So we can go back to any previous phases to refine phases based on evaluation of results at the end of any of these phases. So this is, I mean, the main path, but we can go back in any moment to any of the previous phase and then go on again. So application domain is the key point. And all research and all works focused on human-computer interaction imply to study application domain and to find efficient solution, usable solution, so solution which are effective, efficient, and satisfying users for some specific problem. And this problem can be of any kind. For example, here I put in this slide three application domain I work in. Emergency management, for example. All application able to support, for example, rescuers after a catastrophe like an earthquake, or support even victims of the earthquakes. Technology enhanced learning, supporting teachers and students, for example, even students with cognitive problems. We worked in a European project aimed at designing technology enhanced learning system for children with cognitive problems in the comprehension of text, and technology enhanced treatment of autism. And this is the application domain for which I'm going to give some example. We collaborate with colleagues from the DISCAB department, both psychologists and medical doctors, working with children with autism spectrum disorder. And in particular, we studied how virtual reality application can be used for supporting people with ASD. Actually, what I mean, this is a consolidated literature result. Synthetic worlds can be of great help for people with autism, because synthetic words are somehow controlled environment, simpler than real world environments, and for this reason they are perceived as safer, less scaring than real world. We all know that people with autism have problems in interpreting, for example, non-verbal communication, and in facing unfamiliar situation. Of course, in a synthetic environment, you cannot encounter these problems. You are safe for this problem. And so synthetic environments can be used as sort of training setting, in a sort of progressive desensitization, in which people learn to face more and more complex situation. Just to make an example, we can design a synthetic setting where a person meet one different person, or when they learn to face one person, they can meet two different person, and then three different person whose behavior is controlled, which is not the case of real world. If you go in the street, you cannot control the behavior of other people. But in this case, in a synthetic world, behavior of other person, which may be avatars, is controlled. Also, in a synthetic world, you can control the degree of details of the world. For example, we can have a photorealistic world or non-photorealistic world, which are simpler to be interpreted by people with autism. So, in the literature, the usage of synthetic world is recognized as an appropriate means for teaching social understanding, promoting role play, and allowing participants to take a first-person role in virtual social situation in view of the same activity and the same social problems in the real world. So, actually, when we talk about virtual reality, we talk about a continuum from the real world to the totally immersive virtual reality. In this continuum, what changes is the degree in which the real world is cut off from our view. So we have augmented reality, in which we see the real world augmented with some virtual objects. We have augmented virtuality, in where the virtual world is augmented with some real world objects, up to the virtual reality in which we don't see the real world. Actually, when virtual reality applications are devoted to so-called typically development people, so people which do not have autism, experience, the efficacy of the immersive experience is measured according to at least these three aspects. High immersion, the degree of immersivity, the degree of sense of presence, and the degree of suspension of disbelief, which is the extent to which the virtual world is temporarily accepted as reality. And in the case of typically developing people, for these three factors, the higher, the better. So you, your experience is efficacious, is a good experience if is a high immersion, high sense of presence, a high suspension of disbelief. So we made a study with people with autism to compare the two situations the case of totally immersive virtual reality and the case of augmented reality, in which we have the real world augmented with some virtual objects. I cannot show a picture from the real experiment because of privacy reason, of course. So these are just general pictures. And what we found out is that in this case, the situation is different. Which we single out a set of different scenarios. For example, these are two scenarios of the experiments, differing in the degree of photorealism of images. So we selected a set of scenario, a set of activities that people had to perform in these synthetic environments, and we measured engagement according to two different set of factors. A first set of factors more related to the traditional pillars, immersion, sense of presence, suspension of disbelief, measured according to a five value scale, and then other engagement factors measured in a qualitative way based on our observation of what was going on during the experiment: facial expression of people, level of attention, emotional participation, and verbal reaction. So we found out that according to the traditional factors, the engagement was rented as medium, while according to observational factors, the engagement of these children, they were not actually children, boys in their 20s, the engagement was really very high. That means that the measure used for typically developing people does not apply to people with autism. And in particular, the difference between typically developing people and people with autism was related to the photorealisms and the suspension of disbelief. While in typically developing people, photorealism is considered a crucial aspect, in this case, we found out that people with autism preferred not photorealistic images, for example, this scenario, because, as I said before, is simpler to be interpreted because it has a few details, a lower quantity of details than photorealistic images. Also, suspension of disbelief was low. That is the extent to which the virtual world is accepted as reality, but this was not a negative factor in this case, because when we asked them if they were scared by what they were experiences, they told us that they couldn't be scared because it was clear that that was not the real world. For the whole duration of the experiment, they clearly perceived the fictitious nature of the environment they were immersed in. But this is a good point for treatment of autism, because since they do not perceive these settings as real, they are not scared by them. So we found out that totally immersive environment can be used as training settings in which learning to confronting to a situation more and more complex, while augmented reality tools can be used as cognitive processes to be aware in everyday life to augment the scary real world with familiar objects. We found out that familiarity of objects was a key point. So people could wear these glasses and see the real world as populated by familiar objects, maybe avatars, simple to interpret and can be can work as a mediator between the people with ASD and the real world. I don't know if I have a bit more time. Maybe.
Sure.
5 minutes. Sure.
Yes, of course.
Okay. So as I said before, I want just to promote an initiative of my department to involve girls in STEM. Starting from some studies that see learning approaches centered on project work and integrated program as beneficial not only for learning STEM independent of the gender, but it seems that integrated study tend to be more favorable to gender and social equality. So we designed intensive summer camp, 2 weeks on computer science, information engineering, and mathematics, whose activities are designed around applications. We have just seen how the importance of the which is the importance of application for a human-centered view. We build all the teaching activities and the laboratory experience around selected application. There are plenary theoretical lectures and team project-based laboratories. We already had 4 editions of Pink Camp. The first 2 editions, no, 3 editions, sorry. The first 2 were, of course, in presence, and these are pictures from the second edition. Last year, of course, with the COVID emergency, we had a virtual camp on Teams, and we replicate the virtual experience this year. The last week of June and the first week of July. And we had incredible results from these girls. At the end of the summer camp, there is a context where a group of Pink Campers presented their work with a jury composed by professional women, mostly women, working in STEM. And the jury in all editions said that it was really very, very difficult to select the best project because all projects were of an incredibly high quality, both in terms of ideas, implementations, and presentation from this girl. Is impressive the degree of the ability of critical analysis from a scientific point of view of the work they have done that these girls reached in just 2 weeks, suggesting that actually this integrated approach, which starts from application, can be an interesting direction for rethinking the way we teach STEM disciplines. And that's all.
Thank you very much. It was a very, very interesting talk, and so we are very happy to have you here today. So I think I see some questions. If you want, I can read them for you, which are related to the gender gap.
Mm-hmm.
So Marco is asking, when do you think the gender gap begins? Do you think it starts with parents who start to direct their daughters towards certain disciplines deemed feminine? Or does it start when they join society through school and peer pressure?
I think it is that is a combination of these factors, because, I mean, we know now there's all these debates around toys, no? Male toys and female toys. And, for example, now we have the Barbie doll declined in many occupations, but it is the first example. Actually, for example, in my case, maybe because I have a brother of almost my same age. So in my home, we had feminine toys and male toys, and I used both. And so to me, it was the same, playing with little soldiers, playing with a rifle, or playing with a doll. And my favorite toys, I mean, one of my favorite play was the lamb for landing on on the moon. And actually, I wanted, when I was a child, I wanted to be either a ballerina or a Nobel Prize winner.
It's always good to have yes, dreams.
I discourage people for having such high dream, because you will be dissatisfied. You will be always feel not realized.
But in any case, I think it is true that there is a combination of motivations for the gender gap. So I think Marco was, I don't know if he was actually referring to what we interpret as gap, like the difference that we have at the beginning when girls and boys start their studies at the university, and then at some point this gap starts to become even larger at some point of the career. So that is, in that case, also probably...
I show that the figures have 15 years old. At 15 years old, the gap is already huge. So it started maybe in primary schools.
Yeah, so we at the university, of course, can monitor that and can also, I think, try to be as role models for newcomers. But I think this has to be monitored also at lower levels of education, like high school or...
That's why in camp we work with the girls of 16 and 17 years old, because we have to work with young girls. And actually similar initiative should be done even with scuola media. Preteen.
Earlier than the high school, of course. Yeah. My question is also, can you elaborate on how, practically, maybe? You have been showing some percentages about how, in general, the jobs position will increase, or can you elaborate on this? So how the diminishing the gender gap will, how the other, how males or the other part of the world will benefit from this, from the possible diminishing of the gender gap in the future?
First of all, I mean, I know that the other part of the world is not interested in benefits for women. We know that. But the study showing that impressive impact on gross domestic product, I mean, if we look at the economy as an index of quality and of improvements, which is not my case. I mean, I think that economy is important, but I think that the most important improvement is cultural, because as I said, in this moment the society is designed, shaped by white men. White men are a small portion of humanity. And humanity belongs to everybody, and everybody has to contribute to the shape of the society. So including the inclusion is always a cultural improvement. The inclusion not only of women, but also, for example, black men, which are in this moment are not working in computer science. If I go to a conference in computer science, I find white, almost white people, and maybe people from India, from Asia. But there's this.
So it is of course clear that the gender issues are a part of the problem.
Yes,
of the problems related to.
The real problem.
Diversity and inclusion
of this problem.
Yeah, so this is also very interesting, and we hope also maybe in the future to have some experts also on the diversity and inclusion issues.
Some interesting figures, I don't have the numbers here. In countries less developed, like African countries and other countries, a lot of women are studying and working in STEM. So,
yeah, I know.
Okay.
And yeah, there are several studies also in some, so in Europe about this, regarding the Eastern countries, and this is quite similar. So, in Eastern countries, more women work in STEM.
Yeah.
Like more than, for instance, in Italy or in Germany. And what I understood was that the conclusion that people working in social sciences could get was that in those countries, so the motivation is that in those countries they earn much less in those fields. And so that was one of the motivations, but it is a very complex thing to be studied. So I think for this we have to rely on the statistics and on the people from social studies. But it is I mean, it's not just in the African countries; it is also in Europe, as far as I understand. While, for instance, in more developed countries like Germany, this is, the percentage of women also in academia reaching the highest levels, like in the full professorships, is quite low compared to the Eastern countries. So this is very interesting, and I hope
so
it is...
Italy, in the career, men... And women have different career. I mean, women goes up and men goes up, and women cannot reach.
So, I hope
levels.
This can be starting point for other people here listening who didn't know about this or who just feel this. Difference of presence of women and men because they are now master students and they start looking at this difference. So I hope this is this webinar was a starting point maybe for improving their knowledge about this and maybe also joining the activities that we have at the University of Rotterdam, like PIN Camp, or we have a working group on gender issues at the university. And there are also several other small activities like this seminars or discussions. So I really hope that we gave some starting point to think about these issues in this day. And I hope that if there are other questions or curiosities, you can reach us or Professor Tarantino, who is very, very expert on this. And so, I don't know, I think there are no other questions. So Laura, do you want to say something more?
I want to thank you for this invitation, and I'm always happy to share this consideration with others, because at the moment, one of the, of the weapon we have is to share what we know, what we already discovered about how to improve the situation, and I hope I actually debunked some stereotypes around about computer science. Actually, I'm wearing glasses, but I'm also a dancer, so.
So we discovered that these things can go together. So being a dancer, wearing glasses, and being an electronic engineer.
If I have to find something to close, I suggest that studying classical ballet is an important prerequisite for becoming good researchers in sciences, because many attitudes from classical ballet are really useful for performing research. I mean, for example, for making sacrifices, persevering, perseverance, the ability to see the details and the global picture, the ability to cooperate with others, to synchronize with others, to measure times. I can make an incredible long list. Maybe other disciplines have the same benefits, but surely ballet has.
I think it is a very relevant example and suggestion. And
so
I really
please dance sure. Smart researcher.
Thanks a lot for your time today. Thanks a lot for all your advices and all the information you gave about this issue. And it was very nice for us to have you here. So next week, let me announce, next week we should have a seminar about neutrino physics, so we change the topic. And thanks a lot, Laura, and thanks
Thank you.
Everybody who attended today. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Have a nice, bye, everybody.
Day. Bye. Thank you.